Immersed in the promises of baptism, let us give thanks for what God has done for us. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your voice thundered over the deep, and water became the essence of life. Adam and Eve beheld Eden's verdant rivers. The ark carried your creation through the flood into a new day. Miriam led the dancing as your people passed through the sea into freedom's land. In a desert pool, the Ethiopian official entered your boundless baptismal life. Look, here is water.
Here is our water of life. Hallelujah.
At the river, your beloved son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you opened the floodgates of your reconciling love, freeing us to live as Easter people. We rejoice with glad hearts, giving all honor and praise to you. Through the risen Christ, our source of living water, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Look, here is water.
Here is our water of life. Hallelujah.
Spirit. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray.
Almighty God, with joy we celebrate the day of our Lord's resurrection. Let the grace of Christ among us enable us to show the power of the resurrection in all that we say and do. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Congregation may be seated as we hear God's word from Holy Scripture.
Is from the book of Acts. To put this reading into context, while the apostles testified to others about the resurrection of Jesus, the early Christian community shared what they owned or sold their possessions to help their fellow believers who were in need. A reading from Acts. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions. But everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and grace was held upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them, and each brought the possessions, the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it all at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each of as any had need. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The responsive singing is from Psalm 133.
How good and how pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity.
It was like fine oil upon the head, flowing down upon the beard, upon the beard of Aaron, flowing down upon the collar of his robe.
It is like the dew of heaven, flowing down upon the hills of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing of life forevermore.
The second lesson is from the book of 1 John. To put this reading into context, the opening of his letter serves as a reality check. The reality of God is light, but our confessed reality has been sin. God cleanses us from our sinful reality through Christ's death so that we live in fellowship with Christ and walk in God's light. A reading from 1 John. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testified to it, and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all of sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all of unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. And he is atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. The word of God, the word of life.
continues as the risen Jesus appears to his disciples. His words to Thomas offer a blessing to all who entrust themselves in faith to the risen Lord. The Holy Gospel according to the 20th chapter of John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
I'd like to preface my message this morning that I am not reading a scripted sermon, that these are not from a particular sermon, but these are mostly my thoughts of this story that is read every year on this same Sunday after Easter. And I still love to hear it. So over the next few weeks, we're going to hear different stories from the risen Christ, and we want to understand them. Some of the stories may be familiar, yet the stories repeat that Jesus is risen. Today we heard the story from John's Gospel that Jesus is coming to his disciples and breathing on them his holy peace. Jesus speaks to them these words, "Peace be with you." He's gifting them with the Holy Spirit. So let's just pause a moment and live in that gift of the Holy Spirit. Jesus gifted each of us with the Spirit of peace. So I invite us all to just pause, breathe in, breathe out, to refresh that joy of Easter, to be still and know that God is still God, to know that he is here and with each one of us. So let's breathe in God's peace. Peace be with you. We say these words within our liturgy because Jesus gave us this peace. Jesus speaks these words of peace to the disciples who are huddled together in fear on the night of the resurrection. He repeats them again a week later as the disciples are gathered, this time when all the remaining 11 are gathered, including one named Thomas. Thomas, have you heard of him before? How's this Thomas often referred to? Yep, Doubting Thomas. There are pop culture references to people who are doubting Thomases, right? Well, this is unfortunate for several reasons. First, did you notice that Thomas is never referred to as doubting in the entire narrative? The only time he is given a nickname in the entire Gospels, he is called the twin, not Doubting Thomas. So why has he been disparaged as the doubting disciple? Well, I think part of the reason is because we think that the opposite of faith is doubt. That somehow, if we have doubts or questions, if we are unsure, or if we want to challenge Scripture, that somehow we are doubting, and doubting's a bad thing. There's this idea that we should believe wholeheartedly and never ask questions. Right? Really? I don't think so. Questions and doubts and wonderings have been central to the entire story of the disciples since Jesus first called them. There were disciples who weren't sure who Jesus was, what he was about, and they wanted to know. So they asked questions and challenged him. Even the gospel reading for the resurrection, which we heard just last week in Mark's version, the women went to the tomb, not expecting Jesus to be alive, even though he told them he was going to be resurrected. The women likely went to the tomb with doubts and questions and a lot of fear. But they left in amazement and confusion at what they had seen and been told. They were given instructions to go and tell the disciples and Peter. Why explicitly Peter? Because he truly needed that message after denying Jesus. So when the women go and tell the disciples of this amazing thing that has happened, but the disciples doubted them. The men think that these women are speaking utter nonsense. They wanted their own proof. Well, wouldn't we? It would be hard to accept that Jesus was resurrected after witnessing him hanging on a cross, right? Throughout the Gospels, we get stories of the disciples questioning Jesus, pushing back and challenging him, asking him what he means and trying to understand what Jesus is talking about. He needed to explain many of his parables to them because they didn't get it. But this questioning and the seeking further information makes sense because many of the followers and the disciples, the men and the women, were Jewish. And in Judaism, discussing the events with interpretations is an essential act of the faith. So it makes sense that many of those who followed Jesus would question and challenge. They would push back and they would doubt. So how did we get to the thought that doubt is the opposite of faith? Well, let's think about this encounter between Jesus and the disciples. When Jesus first somehow appears to the disciples, the group doesn't include Thomas. The second time that Jesus appears, Thomas is present. I think we can learn a lot from these encounters about the way we treat each other and how to live with our doubts and questions, and to still live in our faith. Our gospel reading starts on the very first Easter evening. The women have told what they know, and 10 of the original 12 male disciples are locked in a room because they're afraid. Jesus miraculously somehow appears to them, shares his peace, and shows them his hands and side. Then they rejoice and are excited. They're so excited that they tell Thomas, who hadn't been there, that Jesus was in fact alive and that they'd seen him. We aren't told why Thomas is missing, but he really felt like he missed out. I think Thomas reacts exactly as all of the men had reacted to the women's announcements. They all had questions, wanting to believe, but still needed proof. When Jesus appears the next week and Thomas is there, Jesus says the same thing that he had said the week before. Peace be with you. He then shows Thomas his hands and his side. Here, Thomas, put your finger here. Don't be unbelieving, but believe. And Thomas answered with joy and reverence, "My Lord and my God." Thomas acknowledges him as the Lord, thus reaffirming his commitment to Jesus. This is a wonderful encounter between Jesus and the disciples. We can learn from Jesus how to treat one another with peace and love, with hope and forgiveness. Jesus wanted to be sure that Peter heard that he had risen. Why? I think it was to let him know that Jesus forgave him and loved him. Why did he appear to the disciples who had deserted him? Again, Jesus forgave them and loved them. Jesus never chastises Thomas. He never calls him out and never belittles him for his questions and his doubts. I don't hear Jesus speaking to him with an angry tone of voice when he addresses Thomas. Jesus acts as Jesus so often acts, with compassion, love, peace, and forgiveness. As Pastor John Schreiber from Sydney, Ohio once stated, we are all Thomases. We first want to see proof then we will believe. We are all members of the tribe of Thomas, questioning and challenging what we hear and what we read. But we cannot remain in doubt. We must believe by faith. Jesus doesn't seem surprised or disturbed by our questions and our doubts. He responds to us with the same things he did for the disciples, with peace, love, grace, compassion, and forgiveness. He says to us, just as he said to the disciples, peace be with you. Alleluia and amen.
Church cries out, O God, and you listen. As you drew near to the disciples, draw near to us this day. Breathe on us your Holy Spirit, that our faith is renewed and we witness to your love. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your creation cries out, O God, and you listen. Nurture trees, crops, wildflowers, and all growing things. Guide farmers, gardeners, arborists, and others who tend the soil and nurture plants into life. God of grace, your world cries out, O God, and you listen. Guide police, firefighters, paramedics, and other first responders to work for the well-being of communities and the dignity of every person, that no one may need to live in fear. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your children cry out, O God, and you listen. Hear your people crying out for justice, for an end to racism and other oppression, and for a world where all are fed and safe. We pray for all who cry out in suffering or pain, especially the homebound, Darlene, Judy, and Maybeth. We also pray for those in need of healing, comfort, or strength. Chuck Smith, Manye Schmidt, Bob Bakos, Sandy Bakos, Tom Bakus, Herb Wendt, Frank Mizuko, Linda Gooding, Rich K, Sonia A, Bobby L, Jerry Pearl, Michael D, Timothy S, Connie Ellington, Jennifer Ellington, Jerry L, Wendy L, Jack Young. For those receiving care from Stephen Ministers, and those we now name, either silently or aloud. Your congregations cry out, O God, and you listen. Renew pastors, deacons, musicians, and other staff, administrators, and volunteers who facilitated Holy Week and Easter worship. Open our hearts to discern where God calls each of us to serve. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
We rejoice in the baptismal anniversaries of Carson Brewer and Lynn Smith. Bless the gifts of children in this congregation and in this community. Especially today, we thank you for Tristan Liebenguth. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Accept our gratitude, O God, for the lives of those who now rest in you, especially Dietrich Bonhoeffer, and all whose lives have been given in faithfulness to the gospel. Grant us your peace amid our fears. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, most merciful God, we command all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love, through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
You now may share a sign of peace.
Got
all my needs.
Let us pray. Risen One, you call us to believe and bear fruit. May the gifts that we offer here be signs of your abiding love. Form us to be your witnesses in the world through Jesus Christ, our true vine. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so, with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Sending your Son to be our Redeemer. We give you thanks for Jesus, who living among us healed the sick, fed the hungry, and with a love stronger than death gave his life for others. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his life-giving death and glorious resurrection, we await your promised life for all this dying world. Breathe your Spirit on us and on this bread and cup. Carry us in your arms from death to life, that we may live as your chosen ones, clothed in the righteousness of Christ. Through him, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, both now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
The risen Christ is made known to us in the breaking of the bread. Come and eat at God's table.
Thank you. thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise.
Let us bring
together on our knees. Let us praise God together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun, oh Lord, have mercy on me.
Congregation, please rise for the blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the gifts of his body and blood strengthen, keep, and unite us now and forever.
Amen.
Let us pray. Shepherding God, you have prepared a table before us and nourished us with your love. Send us forth from this banquet to proclaim your goodness and share the abundant mercy of Jesus, our Redeemer and friend. Amen.
Amen.
Congregation may be seated for congregational announcements this morning. I know Eric has an announcement for us, right?
Okay. So this is kind of a public service announcement. I know you guys have probably heard plenty about the eclipse, but I did want to go over just a couple of things about how to view it safely. It sounds like it's not going to be raining tomorrow. Hopefully the weather will clear up enough that we can see what happens. If it does, it's going to be spectacular. But so the sun is no more dangerous tomorrow than it is any other time, first of all. But looking at the sun is always dangerous, and looking at the lunar eclipse is no different than that. The reason why it's dangerous is because when you were younger, perhaps, did you ever take like a magnifying glass lens that's a strong plus lens, and you could hold it and the sun, you could focus the sun into all that sun's energy into a small point, and you could actually burn things with it? Okay, well, your eye is a plus lens too. It's about five times stronger than that magnifying lens that you used, and all that sun's energy is focused in your eye right at the most critical part, your macula, in even a smaller area. And it burns the inside of the eye just like it burned that paper or leaf, whatever you were doing before. So there's a real danger there. So it's not good to look at the sun without protection. It within about a second, you can start to have damage start. Okay, so there are definitely approved glasses, and I have actually a bunch of them here because we overbought a little bit at our practice. And so if anybody needs one, I'm going to go up to the front of here after we're all done, and I'll just give you one, okay? But when you put these on, people wonder, well, are they safe? When you put the glasses on, and you can, you know this from last week, you put them on, you can't see anything. Okay, it's just black, all right? But when you look at the sun, it should look like an orange ball. Like last summer, when the smoke from the fires was up in the sky, and in the evening you could look, you could see an orange ball. That's what it should look like through the glasses. If it doesn't look like that, don't trust the glasses, okay? But anyway, you can safely look through all the clips, all you want through these, except through a telescope or binoculars or a camera. Those things magnify the sun more, and these glasses are not effective for that. So don't, the temptation is to pick binoculars up and look through them, that you're not gonna be safe anymore. So please don't do that. They make filters for binoculars and telescopes, but if you don't have that, don't look at the sun, even if you got the eclipse glasses on, all right? When it goes to totality, if we can see that, then it's fine to take the glasses off only while that, it's about 3 or 4 minutes. Only while that is going on, then it's safe to take the glasses off. And when you do, things are going to kind of look different. I want you to be kind of aware of how colors change and that sort of thing, so because there's some unique things that happen with the light that kind of change how colors look during that time. But as soon as you see a little crescent of light around the sun, then you got to put the glasses back on to take a look at it. So if anybody needs glasses, I will have them afterwards, and you're welcome to them. Does anybody have any questions?
Yeah, I got mine at the grocery store because they have those numbers that was shown on TV.
Exactly, yes.
And so maybe if you repeat that.
Okay, yeah, there's a on the temple, which is the side piece of the glasses, there should be this, it should say meets the requirement for, and there'll be a series of numbers. As long as there are a series of numbers there, it's probably okay. The numbers are ISO 12312-2015. So as long as you're in the I've got it up here if you want to write those down. But that your glasses should say that on the temple. But if you put the glasses on and look up at the sun, and you can do it like when you get home or something, even when it's not during an eclipse, if it just looks like an orange ball or a reddish ball, and you don't see any rays coming out from it, you're going to be okay. Okay?
Thank you, Eric.
Any other questions? All right, very good.
Thank you, Eric. And the reason for those who don't know that you are an authority on this is?
I'm an eyewitness.
So there you go.
I listened to our lecture on this.
Okay, any other announcements this morning? Yes, Summer.
We've got another round of handbells starting, so if you're looking to join us for this session, we are on Wednesdays at 6 o'clock at UCC, and we're looking to play somewhere toward the end of May. And this is a great time of the liturgical year, which means it's kind of the fun, uplifting, we can say hallelujah again time, so it'll be a fun piece.
Thank you. Yes?
Can I say just one more thing? Doctors Without Borders collects these eclipse glasses, and they take them to places in the world that experience eclipse where they can't maybe afford to buy the glasses. So afterwards, if you bring them next week, I will take them, and we'll make sure Doctors Without Borders gets them.
Right? Good to know. Okay, wonderful. Any other announcements? One announcement that I'll share on behalf of folks who are in the new member class with me. It's nice to see that so many of you have names. In my former congregation, we had name tags, and we used to leave them in our mailboxes at church, but I noticed that for some reason, Lutherans had an allergy about wearing their name tags. Hardly anybody would ever wear them, but it's nice to see your name tags, because there are some of us who don't know all of your names. So. And I think this is leading up to the fact that we're going to receive new members into the congregation at the end of this month. So for the month of April, for the benefit of those who are in the new member class, thank you for sharing your names with us. All right, if the congregation would please rise and receive God's blessing upon you for the week ahead. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The God of resurrection power, the Christ of unending joy, and the Spirit of Easter hope bless you now and always.